Before we begin, I want to tell you to go to captain.credit. That's captain.credit. Most people don't realize the number of financial obligations and things that are slightly out of control, especially at this point in your life. First thing you need to do is go to captain.credit, fill out the form, get your life back in order, get your credit back in order. I know it doesn't seem important today, but it will be important tomorrow. That's captain.credit.
Welcome to Black and White Recovery. Your hosts have been associated with recovery programs for over 50 years. This show is not associated or related to any 12-step program. The advice is strictly to be taken as advice, or it may be used for drinking games. Always consult with your sponsor, attorney, doctor, or anyone with more common sense other than Lee.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Black and White Recovery episode three of you guys watching me return to sobriety. So it's been 4 weeks. We're at 4 weeks, right? Based on the count, 3 or 4 weeks.
2 weeks.
Yeah, we skipped last week, so we're on this week. So by the time this comes out, you're at about 3 or 4 days under 4 weeks.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say this because nobody will say it because they're not in a position to say it. Drinking and using is way better than the worst day I ever had sober. Way better. It's
That's a given in Arizona.
Jesus Christ, who came up with that saying?
We laugh at the guy that says it. They're usually 80.
Right, because you don't remember, bro. You don't remember. Right. I can tell you in the last few weeks, fond memories. Sorry, they involved alcohol. Might have been the most fun I've ever had with my clothing on. I mean, I just have to be brutally honest for the room. And there was alcohol involved. So if you're not following along, please go back a couple of episodes and follow along with this section of our recovery show. I relapsed spectacularly. Blowtorched my life spectacularly. Managed to get a new business partner, managed to get a new life, managed to get my mom into the hospital dying of something goddamn unknown. Good Lord, I'm watching a woman erode for no apparent reason in a hospital. And doctors keep going, I don't know. A father with Alzheimer's who's mad at me because his wife is not home. And an ex that won't stop bugging me. So you're all caught up. And by the way, if you're keeping count, no, I'm not sober yet. We're still counting down to December 1st. I'm hoping that's the turn in the show. I'm squeezing in one or two trips to Vegas if it kills me. Oh, and my daughter's in a bus on the way to Utah without me following it like the goddamn FBI or mafia at this moment. So you are all caught up with the show. If that's the drama you're here for, otherwise go back and listen to one of our step episodes. This whole thing will be over in December and I'll be back in meetings and it'll be boring again. And we'll talk about sobriety shit. But right now, this show is for all of you who are struggling or on the edge or on the teeter or what you want. You want to know what the other side's like.
The over under on the newcomer chip is December 1st.
Yeah, I've kind of made that up in my mind. I mean, I think it's before, personally, because of the current events that are going on, right?
Yeah, it should be
because
before.
I'm wondering if I'm going to pull the trigger just to appease an individual. I can't do it for an individual. Well, okay, let's follow that logic, right? For those of you not following along, there is somebody in my life that I care a great deal about. And she has shown an incredible level of honesty and openness to me, right? And it's been comforting in a lot of time of pain. And it's kind of been an unspoken thing between the two of us, even though we're completely platonic friends, that it'll be on the table when it's on the table, right? When the time is right, the time is right. And based
again,
on a sequence
that doesn't happen in Arizona.
Right, I know. So based on a series of events that has happened in the past 24 hours with a member of this goddamn program. This is why I have men trust issues, right? Broke my anonymity. Yeah, technically.
When's the last time he's gone to a meet?
I don't know, but he lives in sober living. That's close enough for my ass.
Well, it ain't
so. Yeah, I agree, which is why I sent him to you. You're kind of in between. Based on what he did, it created a distance and a friction between that person and I. And so I have currently decided that it is better to keep the relationship at arm's length, right? And keep it at a friendship and probably a business relationship for the betterment of the two of us, because I think we're better as business partners and casual friends than anything else, right? There's no reason to get emotionally invested into the outcome when there's no outcome, right? Which is what I do. I think we can tell this from anybody who's a longtime listener. I get emotionally invested into the outcome. Like, if it's not that outcome, the whole world's coming to an end, right? So it is just from a logical standpoint, right? Because I'm starting to turtle up and keep relationships at an arm's length and think that basically all men within the same state as me without around any woman I know is a complete piece of dog crap. That's how I feel. I can't trust a single dude, period. Like, I've now come to the conclusion that all men are fucking scumbags, right? And if you're not a scumbag and you listen to this podcast, consider yourself lucky, right? So here's where I'm at. I'm not going to be emotionally invested in the outcome. I'm going to keep it as light and airy and fucking whipped cream as I can, right? I'm going to keep it at a friendship, which it's been for 12 years. And I'm going to continue to do business because that's what's good for both of us. I'm not going to hold my hat or my hope on being emotionally invested in an outcome because right. I can't. I physically can't with my mom in the hospital, with my dad, with whatever the fuck he has, right?
You got a lot going on.
I mean, well, and to be honest, for anybody listening, and I don't know if I said this at the top, today was the day I needed to drink, right? And if you guys want to know why people who have 20, 30, 40 years relapse and then wind up blowing off their fucking brains, it's for two reasons, because I've talked to them. Number one, their ego won't let them go back to the same rooms they were in being the big dog, right? I don't have a problem. I can walk into any room. Nobody's going to fucking know me. Not a soul, right? I've been gone long enough that maybe I'll hit a face or two. Number two, right? And the biggest one, they can't get over the ego disappointment, right? They can't get over the dilemma of the ego. Well, here's the thing. I've had my ego ripped and snatched from my soul so many times over the last 3 weeks, right? Where I keep laughing in the face of life. Ha ha, life. It's shitty, but I've got this. Ha ha, life. It's shitty, but I've got this. I'm going to tell you the secret of AA, Ian. You ready for this? I have figured it all out. AA has nothing to do with stopping and drinking. It's for when life fucks your ass up, you know a bunch of people who literally that will just keep you from fucking blowing your brains out. That's absolutely. That's all it is. The rest
it has nothing to
the
do 12
with steps, everything else.
It has to do with living life sober.
Living so if life you're sober, there and you guys go ahead.
Living life sober ain't easy. What's that? Is that crack pipe?
Vape.
Oh, it's a vape. Oh, just as bad. Not really.
Well, based on the current report. So
is that a pipe? Is that a
I
pipe?
Am learning. No, it's not a pipe. So I am learning not to be emotionally invested in outcomes. I've been, for those of you not following along, I am in psychotherapy as well, because I'm a traumatized person, right? So when I receive trauma, my first action is to torch the entire goddamn room, right? Burn it all down, right? I can't have things leave me. Even my ex, as you follow along, who fucking violated me to the soul, part of me can't understand letting her go, right? That's just who I am. I don't want anybody to leave me in my life. Why am I being open on this podcast? I mean, there's not enough people to make this actually worthwhile. I mean, I don't mean to disrespect you if you're listening or watching, but truthfully, I know the numbers.
Oh, no. The
right? I'm bearing my soul.
Since this is the season of the train wreck.
That's what you should call it. The season. This will be labeled in future episodes as the season of the train wreck. Well, I already came up with the episode of this because it's the way I feel. It's the Unforgiven, right? I was listening to Metallica's Unforgiven. I'm like, you label me, I label you, right? Just, it is what it is. You guys, all you want, here's the truth. I don't want to cry on one of these videos because I feel like I'm just so fucking Raggedy Ann anyway. But the reality is this. Everybody's going to label you. Everybody's going to label you. Right? So you got to be the bigger person and not label them. And you've got to be the bigger person and be bigger than the situation every time. Right? And the real hardcore truth for any of you listening and wanting to know just how tough it is when, and I mean it, I've literally gone through shit that most of you can't even wrap your goddamn brains around in the past 3 weeks, all at the same time. Am I lying about any of that? I mean, this is a pretty four-car pileup of life throwing shit at you at all at once. Am I wrong?
Yeah, you've got it from all angles. Relationship, family, work, relationship, help.
Again, right?
Yeah.
And then being ballsy enough to go into therapy and having somebody try to claw shit out of the top of you while it's happening. It's a lot.
Well, you don't want right? that.
So here's the real
truth. Your subconscious is causing all this other mishigosh, for lack of a better word, so he can't peel the onion.
Maybe. Maybe there's part of me that can't be Ron exposed and be, like, part of me wants to be who I was when we first started doing this podcast. Cold right. and rational, right? And dealing with life every day at that level. There's no up, there's no down. You're just like on bipolar medication. You're just in the middle. And then there's this part of me that everybody's exposed, either through your kindness or my friend's kindness, right? Where they touch a deep part of your soul. And you're like, is life really like this for normal people? Like, that's crazy to me. That's a crazy thought. Like, real rational people in real rational relationships talk about their feelings. And they put them all on the table like they're a set of playing cards where everything is normal, right? You're going through something bad with your mom. Let me relate to you. That touches me too hard based on the death of my mother. I can't really discuss that. I can't look at that photo, but it's all discussed like rational, like all people, right? And love is given, love is received, it's passed around. And then you get a trust violation or you get an arm's length or you get a disconnection from that. Fuck, bro, what's up? I mean, I've done so much good shit in the last 2 weeks, it's negated by three or four bad things, and I'm ready to go walk out onto the boulevard and stand in front of cars. Just being honest.
Mm-hmm.
And you find this compelling audio?
I'm not that compelled, but somebody might be. I've heard all this already.
All right. Why don't you, I know, because you've been up to date on it. Well, why don't you tell me what you think? Because, like, we're at the point where you should start wrapping up the craziness for everybody. Going, yeah, Lee, you're telling my story, bro. How'd you get through it? I fucking drank. Like, I don't want to break it to anybody. I'm going to tell you the punchline. I went to work. Like, I called my therapist. I called my sponsor. I still drank. I did physical labor. I went out and looked for land. I did healthy things. I called and made amends. I did all that shit. But here's the reality. It's not a country and western song. You don't get all your shit back. You don't. Sorry, that's not how fairy tales work. The fairy tale is you just made it right and that's all there is. How'd I do?
Little manicky, but okay.
It's good for the podcast.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
That's the other thing by the way, that's the other thing my therapist is trying to get rid of. He goes, this manicky thing that happened, that's got to go. That's just, like, you get fucking crazy. I said, well, when I melted down the other night, I mean, it was only 4 or 5 texts as compared to blowing the dude up till 5 a.m. I mean, I think it's growth. I think it shows a lot about the therapy that you provided at this point. Right. I said, look, I'll give myself a D minus on the evening, but I didn't really do anything to the person I was mad at this time. I just got mad and just cut him out of my life. My ex contacted me. I didn't text her back. I didn't get into a war. I didn't engage it. I didn't allow it into my life. I just cut it off. I did the right thing. Those are the right things to do. And I absorbed the pain like normal, rational people should, right? Just take the pain, accept it, find someone to lean on. I just happened to feel that I lost my strongest standpoint on leaning on someone at the moment. And I don't know if that's ever going to come back or if
I can. I think the only human being that could do that is you. I don't think another human being can do that.
I don't know.
I mean, I have a connection with some people where someone will say something negative and it just rolls off their shoulders. It's like, well, if that's what he did, I feel bad, but whatever. And then get on the phone and call me and say, hey, did you do this? And it's like, no, I don't know what you're talking about. And we're fine. And sometimes it's, yeah, I did do that and they deserved it. And yeah, I'll get around to making amends. And we're still fine.
Right.
We're still fine. So, you know, there's just those people in your life that love you unconditionally. And, you know, if that's what you got, no matter what anybody says, isn't going to change a thing.
Well, it's a trust issue now, right? So correct. The inner child in me can't yeah. have
well, you're taken away from scary it at this thing. Moment. I mean,
you're, a you're lot of scary like, things.
You were sober a long time, and now you're not. You're still not, and you know you're looking to burn everything down in your path, and then sometimes you stop, and sometimes you start, and you know it's scary, and you know somebody that has a family, has a business, probably doesn't want to deal with it.
I agree. I don't blame that person who feels that way and the arm's length feeling that I got when talking to them today, mm-hmm. right?
The novelty right? of drinking Lee is starting to wear off on people. These people have all known you when you had, you know, multi-years of sobriety. And now it's yeah. like, okay, oh, man, he's loose. He's funny. He's blah, 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 which you're all those things anyway, usually. But, you know, now after a few weeks, everyone's like, hey, how come he hasn't quit drinking yet?
Right. And here's the scariest thing I have to encounter. Basically 10 hours of driving tomorrow alone with myself going to Utah, right, from L.A. to Utah to go see my daughter.
That's brutal. I would almost take a bus just so I could be with 30 people.
Right. I mean – for those of you who don't get it and you feel uncomfortable in your own skin at this moment.
Led Zeppelin 4, Dark Side of the Moon, The Wall, Midnight Madness.
Just keep popping CBD gummies and just go for
the
drive.
Night of the Crime.
Right.
Let's see, what other good albums could I throw in there for you?
Oh, my
1984, God. 1984, OU812, right. Van Halen 2.
Nobody that, appreciated that
enough,
throw up.
That should give you enough headache.
Or I can do work. No, or I can be productive, right? And put audiobooks in to take me out of my own head and try to be productive with my life.
Right.
Which is normally what I do on these drives. But right now, for those of you who think you have voices in your head, when shit goes bad, it goes to 10.
I don't know how you're going to be able to go without a drink for 10 hours.
Oh, no, let's be honest. In 3 hours, I'll be in Vegas, which means a pit stop, right? So yeah, at the very least, a taco and a beer. Then to Utah by 1 or 2 o'clock to see her perform, to turn around to be back in Vegas by 6 or 7. It's brutal. It's fucking brutal, right? It's fucking brutal. Like, I can't think of a harsher punishment for what's transpired in the past 24 hours than to put me alone in a car without people to talk to.
With a break in Vegas.
Nobody. Here's who you should, if you're all listening, the only person you should feel sorry for at this moment is Ian, right? Because this poor fucker is going to get a call every other hour with my fucking craziness and my crazy whatever, right? It's about creating the story in your head and finding false evidence of that story in my brain for that story, even though none of that shit's happening because I'm just driving a car and I'm alone and I'm creating stories in my head based on my life. That's what's going to happen. I mean, I'm trying to say it out loud thinking that'll stop it. No, it's not going to stop it. It's still going to happen. It's just going to, it's like the penance for my, all the work that I've done to get to this moment, all the penance. You want to know what the penance is? Lee, you got to be in a car alone for 10 goddamn hours. Jesus Christ. That's a harsh fucking penance, man. Like, I have to think about every negative thing that I've done in the past couple of weeks and how I could have done it better and try not to keep myself from going on a pity trip and like apologizing and doing all kinds of shit I'll regret. Oh, you're right. You deserve to fuck that dude and treat me like shit. You're right. How do I fix your life better? Please don't leave me, right? That's what comes out of bullshit like that. Was it a good show for you this week? I mean, that was pretty gut-wrenching honesty on some kind of subatomic level.
It was.
God damn. Sadly, I think my therapist is starting to listen to these just so he can fuck with me more. And I love the guy. No, I gave him the link. I mean, on some kind of weird subatomic level, I'm outing myself, right? I keep making amends. I'm being less aggressive when my inner child feels like it just got fucked up the ass. I'm trying. I mean, for those of you listening, going, all of you listening with any kind, it's tough. And I'm going to say this for anybody listening. For anybody listening with less than 30 days and feel you don't have your shit together, you got your shit more together than me at this moment. I mean, I'm just being perfectly honest. You've got your shit together more than me. And yeah, do I have a car? Do I have a life? Do I have friends? Do I have all that shit? Yeah, but I don't trust anybody. At this moment, I trust nobody. Ian's safe. He's out of the state, right? Like, that's what makes him special at the end of the day. My therapist is a paid participant in the circus that is my life at this moment. But there are people that you and I both know that I feel are compromised based on relationships, right?
Right.
And that's pretty actual at this moment, right? There's a whole fucking circus that's going on based on the drama of my life that even if I were sober, that's a lot of drama. That's, I mean, it's a substantial level of real. This isn't like made up in my head. This is real shit happening between work, my family, personal relationships. Like, this shit's really happening. All right, go ahead and talk sober shit so it sounds like a real show.
A real show? This is supposed
to be
about
a sobriety show.
Side of the dark side of recovery.
This isn't even the dark side of recovery, to be brutally honest. I mean,
no, it's the dark side of drinking.
I don't like drinking is not the issue. Drinking is, and I understand this. It's an escape, right? That's escalating itself to shut down ultimately the voices and the nagging feeling in my pit, right? And the more the doctor digs, the bigger the pit is. The more I emotionally invest in new situations or outcomes, the bigger the pit becomes, the bigger the anxiety. The sicker my mom gets, the deeper the anxiety, right? And alcohol, better or worse, does a pretty damn good job of making you believe that that's not real.
But it is real.
It is real. And it needs to be processed. It needs to be accepted. And sometimes people get mad. And sometimes you hurt people. I mean, that's just real.
Right. Right. Usually when you act out, you hurt people.
Right. Right.
Including yourself.
Including myself, right? Oh, and on top of it, fuck the work with a guy that I would never fucking work with in my entire life. Like, you're just going to toss a double Lindy into this situation and toss a guy that I would never speak on a stage with.
Well, you have to separate work. You can't get some work you can't get emotional about. It's okay to get passionate, but to get emotional about work is ridiculous.
If in the sober version of Lee, do you think that I would ever deal with a guy like this ever?
No.
Right.
You wouldn't even have had dinner with him.
Right. certainly wouldn't have gotten down on one knee and literally and figuratively blown him in front of a full room of people to show his dominance over me as a speaker, as a force in real estate. I mean, that's just
right.
That's just me showing off in front of somebody that I care about, right? That I can do the task. This is what you want. This is what our partners want. You want me to play ball. This is what I have to do with a guy like this. So I'll do it.
Did you say figuratively?
Literally and figuratively. Yeah, no, literally. I did it in a restaurant. Yeah, I just got down and zipped his pants and blew him. He did give me $50. So I made a couple of bucks on the deal.
Oh, there you go.
And by the way, if you're gay on the show, I'm not shitting on you. It's a joke. Jesus Christ. Politically correct society that we live in. Well, and girls, if there are any girls who listen to the show. Well, I'm going to say this for any of the girls who listen. Hey, if you are making $50 for blowing guys, I'm not shitting on your work either. You do God's work. Okay. I'm just saying it.
You have got to stop drinking and go to a meeting.
I agree, right? I'm not at the point to disagree with that logic.
December 1st,
right? I knew it. Look, who's the first person I called that? Did I not out myself the minute I went, oh shit, I got a drink? Like, not, I want to go have a drink. I want
to
go have a drink.
You didn't out it to me. I didn't hear it from you.
No, I told it to you today. I said, I need to drink. I don't want to drink anymore. I need to drink. Like, it's not going to stop organically. Like, it's...
All that stuff was going on in your life for 25 years when you weren't drinking.
No, Ian, you've known me for a good chunk of those years, and I don't think that I've ever seen a show like this before. In fact, I'm positive I've never seen a show like this before. I've never seen... The one thing I'm not doing, which I'm proud of, right? So I'm an escapist, right? Eat bad food, do bad things to myself, turn on the TV, and let time just click by until it all gets better, right?
Right.
I haven't watched TV in 4 weeks. I haven't watched wrestling. I haven't eaten a pizza. I've actually been fasting and doing keto.
So all of your escapes you've replaced with alcohol?
Yeah, actually, I have.
All those things that you enjoy, you've replaced with alcohol.
How addictive of me.
Yes.
You're all caught up. Say something sponsory, because somebody's nodding at
I
their
can't say sponsory. You're still drinking.
All right. I'm just telling you, there are people listening going, I know how he feels.
Yeah, I know how you feel too.
Bro, this is fucked. Like, these last 3 or 4 weeks have been fucked up. Like, I can't even fucking believe the level of fucked up.
I mean, I've everything you've gone through, I've gone through sober. They just haven't been so close.
Right. Look, if they were one at a time, I could mitigate the damage, right?
Right.
Focus here, go here. So when you go and focus here, oh shit, that just blew up too.
Yeah.
I mean, well, looking at consecutive
blow-ups. I think your whole thing is, you are in tremendous fear of being alone with yourself, both in present and in future. Mm. And I think your mom, the realization of what's going on with your mom, you know, as upsetting as it should upset you. I think breaking off of one relationship, giving you more aloneness, is pouring fuel on the fire. And then this new deal, you know, maybe yes, maybe no, probably not, maybe okay. That's another relationship about to go south, to become friends and in business. And I think it all feeds into your huge fear that you're going to grow old somewhere by yourself with 20 or 30 cats.
And by the way, just so you know, you and my therapist are on the same page. The greatest fear I have and that I have exposed just for everybody listening is don't leave me, don't leave me, don't leave me alone. Right. The trauma that I have.
Mm-hmm.
Don't leave me alone with these people that are going to abuse me. Don't leave
but
me here
then
by myself.
You wind up pushing them away.
Well, yeah, I'm self-destructive. I mean, what kind of fucking addict isn't destructive?
Well, I get that, but your destruction, you're destructing the solutions to your greatest fears.
Well, it's kind of a day late and a dollar short, isn't it? for your fucking happy insight.
I'm just saying. That's what I see going, hey, I do the same thing.
Give a message of hope.
The message of hope is there's different ways to fill the void than with alcohol. Some days it may be a higher power. Some days it may be a pizza. Some days it may be acting out. But you don't have to fill it with alcohol.
The management apologizes for today's show. Please send your complaints to blackwhiterecovery@gmail.com. That's the words black, the word white, and the word recovery at Gmail.
A taco.